Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. God, truthfully for me, the time off, it felt very different, very weird not to come together corporately to worship. But it was awesome to me, God, how you showed me in those weeks off that you don't need me. That, God, you're going to do what you're going to do. And so it was just an incredible time for me to sit back and look upon you and know that, God, you in fact got this. But God, I pray that as we come together today and we do meet corporately, that really, God, this isn't the culmination of the week, that this is just the beginning of our interaction with you. God, that you would meet each and every person here individually, that you would open our hearts to hear from you. God, it's not about the words that I speak, but God, that you speak through me and you meet each person where they are. And I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we got the bug shaken off. We ready to go? Yeah. Apparently, we are, right? Okay, how about this? It's a great day to be a... All right, much, much better. Hey, we are starting a brand new series today called Timeless. And it's a series that I've been thinking about, praying about for the past few months. And it seems so fitting right now because it's a new year. And what comes with the new year? New year's resolutions, right? Everybody's making resolutions. I want to be different. I want to do this different. I want to make these changes in my life. And unfortunately, most of the time, if they are not broken by now, right, they will be broken by the end of January. We all have good intentions. We just lack the follow through. I'm not talking at you. I'm talking with me because that resonates with me, right? So I thought, man, this is going to be a perfect time for us to decide right now that there are some things that God tells us through his word that never go out of style, that are always relevant to us, right? So timeless principles. The best things in this life are timeless. And so my news feed, beginning at the beginning of the new year, started popping up with new trends we could expect, new things in 2017. This is going to be new. These are going to be new. All the stuff, and we live, I mean, if we're honest with each other, we live in a trendy world, right? All the time, things are trending, business trends, fashion trends, hairstyle trends, economic trends, music trends, movie trends, all these trends, the list could go on and on and on. And so I thought what would be helpful for you is if I showed you some practical examples. So here we have some pictures I want to show you of trends. How about that? How about that hairdo? Is that a trendy hairdo? Yeah, not now it's not, right? But in the day, it was rocking, right? I had some MC Hammer pants, the Z Cavariccis. Don't laugh at me because some of you had some too, right? Next picture. Do we know who that is? The Durs. Yeah, look at that. Classy stuff. Next picture. Oh, yeah. The Durs again. Someone said in the first service, what is it, a day about the Durs? And I said, no, they're the only ones that responded to the email to send pictures in, right? So, look, hey, I love that shirt that Dennis is rocking right there, right? Yeah, and the wood paneling reminds me of my grandma and grandpa's house. Every time I go over there, they had wood paneling all over their house, so it takes me back to where they're at. Next picture. Yeah, the jumpsuit, right? The jumpsuit. What would that be like if we wore that jumpsuit today? Not me personally, because that would just be a weird thing, would it not? Next picture. I don't even know what to say about that one, except for I look at the chops. The chops were in style. My dad had some chops, right? Next picture. Oh, the puka shell necklace. Anybody wear one of those? Anybody still wearing one of those? Don't tell nobody. I'm just kidding. All right, next picture. Bam. Bam, hashtag saved by the bell, right? The cell phone, there's actually multiple things in this picture. So the cell phone, you remember when cell phones came out? Anybody have one of those cell phones when they came out? Yeah. Do you still have it?
No.
Okay. But when you had that, when it came out, that was hot, right? And some people would say, well, Zach from Saved by the Bell, he was hot. But he's still hot, right? Saved by the Bell. So we didn't have that. We had the big gray Nokia, the giant. You got, yeah. See, that resonates with a few more people. I think, is that it or is there any more? That's it, right? Yeah. Okay. So trends all over the place. And here's the thing. What I want you to understand is if I took a picture of you today, in a few short years, you would look back and say, oh, I can't believe I wore that shirt. I can't believe I did my hair that way. I had way more hair then than I do now. I can't believe I did my makeup that way. All that stuff, right? We live in a trendy world, but what I want you to understand is what's trending now is going to become a fad, right? It's going to go out of style, and so I thought it would be awesome for us to stop and say there are some things in this world that are timeless. And I'm not here to demonize trends, okay? That's not the point of this whole series. The point is this, that we live in a trendy world, and there's nothing wrong with that. We're living in a world that's changing, always changing. Live in a world that if you don't change with it, you're going to get left behind. But since we live in a world that changes, in a world that's trendy, it's important for you and I to remember some very important principles about trends. And this is really what I want to talk about over the next several weeks. These overarching principles, and really the overarching principle for this whole series is this. In a trendy world, right, in a trendy world, the best things are timeless. In a trending world, the best things in life are timeless. In other words, there's ways for you and I to live our lives, ways for us to treat people, character traits that come from Scripture that guide our choices that never, ever, ever go out of style. They look good on everybody that wears them, right? And God has given us that in His Word. And God speaks very clearly to us through His Word. It's okay for you and I, again, I'm not here to demonize trends, it's okay for you and I to keep up with those trends until the point that it impacts our lifestyle in a negative way, right? So what I mean by that is my neighbor got a boat. I don't have the money to get a boat, but they got a boat, so I got to get a boat. And then I go into debt up to my eyeballs because I want to keep up with the Joneses, right? So I'm not here, again, to demonize trends, but what I'm wanting you to see is that there are ways for you and I to live our lives. There is principles from God's Word that if we would allow them to guide our choices, guide our decisions, that it would impact the world that we live in a better way always. It never, ever, ever goes out of style. So here's the thing. I want you to understand this. And what I want to do today is I really want to begin in a very important place. Like the where I want to start this whole series off is with eternity. Okay? So eternity is certainly timeless, is it not? Eternity is a timeless thing. And in fact, it's a huge concept and it's a huge truth that I think that we don't really understand. I mean, I think that we have an idea of what it's all about, but we don't truly understand what eternity and what heaven is all about. And so consequently, we have this when we think about eternity, there's a temptation for us to think, okay, I got it, but what does that have to do with my life today? I mean, how does eternity impact the choices that I make every single day? And that's really what I want to address. I mean, someday eternity is going to be important, but it's not important today. And I would say that's false. It's very, very, very important today for you and I to live life, to make choices, to treat people, to do this thing that we call life with an eternal mindset. Okay? Now, once you understand this, once we begin to grasp this, not only for the future, right? Once we begin to grasp the importance of eternity in heaven, not just for the future, but for today, it will have the potential to dramatically impact every single choice, every single thought that you make more than anything else in this life, if we would begin to understand this whole idea about eternity. And I'm not trying to oversell it. I'm not doing the preacher thing and saying, this is going to change your life. I'm telling you, this is a fact. If we would begin to live this way, it will give us a greater perspective on the everyday moments of life in ways that nothing else will. So, with that being said, let's dive in, and I want to ask you a question to sort of prime the pump, to get you thinking, and here's the question. What is heaven like? Just think about it for a second. What is heaven like? When you hear me say the word heaven, what is the first thing that pops into your brain? What are the images going through your mind? I mean, when you think about eternity, when you think about heaven, what do you think it will be like? Okay, peaceful. That's one thing. Love,
worship,
paradise. Okay, all these things, but more. And what we're going to talk about today is I want us to get an accurate picture of what this is like. Because the truth is, and I've been asking this question a little bit to the people that I've been around, it's important for us because Gallup did a poll recently, and the Gallup poll said that 81%, okay, 81% of Americans believe in heaven, right? Don't miss that, 81%. I mean, we can't get 81% of Americans to agree on anything, can we? Right? We can't get 81% of us to agree on the color of chairs if we were sitting in this room, right? But 81% of Americans said that they believe in heaven. However, to take it a step farther, when they were pushed, 81% of Americans also said they don't really have a clear picture of what eternity or heaven is going to be like, what it's, you know, how it's going to look, all those things. And I think that you and I, if we're being honest with each other, fall in those numbers of 81%. I think that there's some confusion that surrounds this. I mean, we believe in heaven, and that we know that when we die, if you have a relationship with Jesus, if I have a relationship with Jesus, I know that when I die, I'm going to spend eternity with him because of that relationship, right? But I don't really understand what it truly means, what eternity looks like. What does heaven look like? What am I going to do all day, every day, for the rest of time, ever, ever, ever? Because some of the questions, when I was asking, I say, what does heaven look like? Well, they say clouds, right? Clouds, lots and lots of clouds. You see it on the movie screen, and anytime you see heaven portrayed on the movie screen, I mean, most of the time you only see people halfway up because they're walking around in clouds, right? Harps, playing the harp, right? We got wings, angels' wings, I'm mopping floors with Morgan Freeman, right? Right, that's the pictures that we get when we talk about eternity and we talk about heaven. And even the things that we were taught as a kid, or we pictured as a kid, I can remember sitting at First Baptist Church, Homestead, Florida, and trying to picture what God looked like and what heaven was going to look like. And if I could be honest with you, I was thinking, man, I don't want to go, right? Because I pictured God, I mean, it was a better option than hell, let's just say that. But in the grand scheme of life, when I was thinking about this, I had God sitting on this big, giant wooden chair. We had one on the platform at the church, right? And the floors were wood. God had a gray beard, and he just sat there and watched. And everybody in this big open room, wood paneling, by the way, everybody was just singing, and that's all we did. Nonstop, 24/7 for eternity, was this God sat on a wooden chair and listened to us sing. Now, I would say that that's a little bit confused, don't you think? I don't think that that's the way heaven's going to be. And you know why? Because Scripture shows us a different picture of that. And so here's what I want you to understand. If you and I don't have a clear understanding of this, then what happens to us? When we minimize heaven or when we trivialize eternity, what happens is we end up marginalizing our lives. And what I mean by that is this, is that the issues here, my kingdom here, it becomes greater and eternity becomes less, right? So the things that I'm dealing with now, eternity doesn't matter. I mean, it matters, but when I minimize it, when I minimize heaven, when I misunderstand heaven, everything that I'm trying to do here becomes that much bigger, and eternity becomes that much smaller. And that's a backwards perspective, because you understand that this life, everything that you're dealing with, everything that you're trying to do here is just a blip, right? Blip. That's it. Boop. Boop. Do I need to keep doing that? Boop. No. And then eternity is this long line that never stops, right? And we get them backwards. And so we tend to end up focusing. When we minimize it or we trivialize it, we end up focusing on the here and now instead of eternity. And I'm telling you, there's a way for you and I to live with eternity in focus that will impact every single decision, every single thought that you have in this life if we can begin to get a clear picture of it. Now, how do we do this? Let me give you a couple of examples. When I said what comes to your mind, you said peace, and you said, I tell you, people often say clouds, right? Clouds. And so I say, what about heaven? And they look up, clouds, all that stuff. The movies, Morgan Freeman, all that stuff. That's where we get confused. But I saw a meme not too long ago on Facebook, and it said, hell won't be all that bad. At least all my friends will be there, right? Now, listen to me. And see, I saw the faces too. Some of us said, right? As Christians, we would never, ever, ever say that, would we? But we do this. We do this. We do this, and we just do it in different ways. We do it in Christianese ways, right? We would say, God, please don't come back until I get married, right? God, please don't come back until I have children. God, please don't come back until after spring break. God, please don't. And you see what happens here is when we misunderstand heaven, we misunderstand eternity, we think the here and now is more important. And when we think of heaven as harps and singing, a guy sitting on a big wooden chair, you know what comes to my mind? Boring. I'm just being honest with you. If that's what eternity looks like, then I think, man, it pales in comparison to the way that I'm living my life now. And what I told the first service is this, and I said this before, but I want you to understand this. As a believer in Jesus Christ, let me just say this. As good as your life is, this is as bad as it gets for you. Right? This is the worst it will ever be for you in light of eternity. So why is it that we're trying to hang on to it like this is the important thing, instead of making every decision, living life through the lens of eternity? Now, when you and I buy into the myth that while heaven is important, right, and while eternity is important, and yes, I want to go there, but it has nothing to do with the way that I live my life now, right? Heaven's so far away and my life is now. What does heaven have to do with the decisions I got to make Tuesday? What does it have to do with this deal or the school that I got going on this week? That's the way that we minimize it and we trivialize it and we tend to marginalize our lives. And as a result, we make skewed decisions. And what I want to do through this series is I want us to shift our paradigm. I want to establish a new framework for us to view everything in life through this, through the lens of eternity. Our truth today is my choices matter forever. My choices, the choice you make right now, and the next choice, they matter forever. Your choices have consequences. I tell my boys all the time, the choices you make have consequences. And they think of consequences just negative. I said, no, there's positive and negative consequences. Not every choice has a consequence, Dad. I'm like, yes, it does. Every choice that you make matters, and every choice that you make has a consequence. Well, Dad, what if I stop breathing? Well, the consequence is you're going to pass out, and then you're going to start breathing again, right? That's what's going to happen. You know, every choice that you and I make has, listen to me, eternal consequences. Every choice, every thought that you and I make has eternal consequences. So here's what I want to do today. I want to show you a powerful truth. I want to show you a timeless truth that's so important. Not only is it going to have huge implications for us for the future, but it will have huge application for us today and every single day that God grants us on this earth until we go to be with Him or He comes back. That's what I want to do today. You know what that means for you and I? It means that the work that you have this week is far more important than you previously thought about. Your job, the things that God's called you to, has far more significant value than maybe you ever thought about. The decisions you make as far as school, far more significant for you than you may have originally thought. It means that how you compete in sports, how you do everything that you do in this life has far more significant value than you maybe even know in this moment. When we begin to understand what God has to say to us through His Word about heaven and eternity and what it's like, we begin to realize how we view our finances is far more significant than maybe we ever have ever thought about. Okay, every area of life, marriages, relationships, friendships, everything in life we do is far more significant when we begin to view it through the lens of eternity. And so that's where I want to begin today, and that's really going to be the theme of this whole series, is that in a trending world, the best things in this life are timeless, right? It spans the test of eternity. And then when you and I have this wrong mental image of heaven, what happens to us, and I said it already, is we tend to hang on to this life with white knuckling for dear life, right? Oh, man, this stuff, I got to hang on to this stuff. But again, as a follower of Jesus, this is as bad as it gets. Why would we hang on to this? Why wouldn't we say, Jesus, come back, I'm ready. I'm ready for eternity. Because we have a misunderstanding. We have a skewed view of eternity and heaven. So, my choices matter forever. When we understand what Scripture says about heaven and eternity, not only does it give us a greater vision, a better vision, a grander vision of what eternity is going to be like, but it gives us a greater and grander vision for our life now, and that's where we're going to go. So, before we go any farther, I want to throw out a disclaimer to you, and here's the disclaimer. I personally have never, ever, ever been to heaven. Does that shock you? It seems dumb, right? But let me explain this. I've never been there. I don't have pictures of it. I've never spoken to somebody who's been there. And why this is important, why I want you to understand this, is because we were talking about taking a cruise next year. If I'm going to take a cruise, am I going to get advice from somebody who's taken a cruise or someone who's not taken a cruise? Participation, right? Somebody who's taken a cruise, right? Well, I've never been to heaven. So why would you take my advice? You're not, right? That was a bait and switch. You're gonna listen to what God has to say about it, because God's going to speak very clearly to us through His Word, and He wants us. Here's the thing. It's not a mystery. It's not a mystery. He wants us to understand what eternity is going to be like. Why? So that it will impact the choices that we make today. Over and over and over and over and over again in His Word, He says, here's what eternity is going to be like. Here's what heaven's going to be like. So, one more question. Let me just prime the pump. Where is heaven? You don't have to shout it out. I'm just saying. If you say, I'm gonna go to heaven, where is that? Is that the typical response? Right? Because we think, oh, it's got to be somewhere up there, right? Hell's down there. Heaven is up there, right? I just wanted to ask you that. You know, what does it look like? Where's it going to be at? So I want you to just think about those things as we dive in. For us to get a clear picture of this, we got to talk about really two misconceptions that people, we, typically have about heaven. And here's the first misconception. Believers in Jesus, hear me out on this, don't shut me down when I say this. Believers in Jesus will spend an eternity in heaven. That's a misconception. Listen to me. That is true, but it's not true, okay? We will spend an eternity with Jesus. But when we think about heaven and the clouds and all that stuff, that's a misconception. So Scripture's clear. You have a relationship with Jesus. You're going to spend an eternity with him in heaven, but it doesn't look like that, okay? Let's just dive in. How about I need to just stop talking and let God talk. How about that? Isaiah 65 is where we're going to start out. And here's what happens. God tells Isaiah. Isaiah is a prophet in the Old Testament. He said, I'm going to give you these words and I want you to write them down because I want everybody to know. I want everybody to know, generation after generation after generation, I want them to know what eternity is going to be like. Isaiah 65, 17, here's what it says. It says, see, I, that's God that we're talking about, see, I will create, what does it say? And a, what? New heavens and a new earth is what he says there. See, I will create new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. Now, here's the other thing. God's going to say, I want to make sure that you understand this, to make sure he's got his point across. The very next chapter, Isaiah 66, 22 says it this way, as the new heavens and the new earth that I will make endure before me, declares the Lord, so will your name and descendants endure. So here's the thing. There it is again, this concept of a new heaven and a new earth, right? It's a huge concept, monumental phrase that we have to understand. For us to understand heaven and what eternity in heaven is going to be like, we have to understand what new heaven and new earth means. And it's really important for us that this idea of what eternity looks like is inclusive of a new earth, okay? Which tells me, because God speaks about it over and over and over again, is that God's not silent. He wants us to know. He wants us to understand. That's Old Testament. New Testament, 2 Peter, right? It's not just pertinent to the Old Testament. God spoke all the way through Scripture. 2 Peter 3:13 says it this way. But in keeping with his promise, that's God, we are looking forward to what? A new heaven and what? Where righteousness dwells. A new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. What is a new heaven and a new earth? What in the world of sports are we talking about? Here's what we're talking about. You and I, as believers in Jesus, we'll spend an eternity with him on the new earth that he's creating. Is that news to some of you? That we're not going up through the clouds to go to heaven? Heaven and earth will be combined, right? It's going to be new heaven, new earth. Let me explain it this way. In the New Testament, you wouldn't know it by having a conversation with me or listening to me. I love words, right? I tend to misuse them and skew them and speak them in redneck, but I love words, and I love the way that words, the meaning of words, changes things, right? So in the New Testament, there are two words for the word new that we see, right? There's the word neos and the word kainos, okay? The word neos describes something brand new, something that's brand new, not been created, it's brand new, right? That's not the word that God describes. That's not the word that's used here when he says new heaven and a new earth. The word is kainos, which means to restore something to its original intent. That's the word that he uses here. Kainos, restoring something to its original intent. So the new earth will be this earth, right? God's not going to destroy it and then make something brand new. God is going to redeem it and restore it to the way that he created it in the first place. That's what he's talking about here. And this is where you and I are going to spend an eternity with him on this redeemed, restored kainos earth. Okay? We tracking? North, south? Okay. All right, now, why is this such a big deal that you and I are going to spend an eternity with him on the new earth? Well, it's a big deal because when we think of heaven and we think of eternity, if we think of it as sitting in clouds or playing harps or sitting in a stereo room together, singing nonstop day in and day out, it's the wrong picture, okay? That's not what Scripture tells us. What the Bible teaches us is if you want to have a more accurate view, a more accurate vision of what eternity is going to be like, we shouldn't go outside and look up and think that's where I'm going someday. We should go outside and look around, okay? And here's the thing that I told the first service. The more that you know about eternity and what it's going to look like, then the better off we are, right? So when you go out and you see a sunset, have you ever done this? I love nature, right? I love nature because nature declares to me that there is a God, that there is a creator. And I can't look at a beautiful sunset or a beautiful sunrise and not know that there's a God who spoke that into creation. And so what I asked them is, have you ever walked outside and looked at a sunset and just thought, oh, man, God, you are awesome. God, it's amazing that you would show that to me. So see, the thing is, I want you to understand this. If you've ever done that, you already know more about eternity in heaven than you give yourself credit for. Because God said, I'm going to redeem that and I'm going to restore that. That's what eternity is going to be like. You will spend an eternity with me in this kainos earth, heaven on earth, right? You got that? Okay. Now, other examples I told the first service. If you've, we went to Gatlinburg, Tennessee this last summer and we were sitting on top of a mountain and I was looking around at the colors all over the mountains and I was like, man, God, you are awesome. I don't know how you could look at that and not know that there's an all-powerful God who opens his mouth and speaks. That didn't happen by accident. There could be absolutely nothing so beautiful that would happen by chance. I said, if you've ever had an incredible meal where the food was just like, and I love me some food, right? With incredible friends, and you thought, I don't want this to end, then you already have a picture of what eternity is going to be like. But we're going to spend it with God. And what's going to happen on this kainos, the restored, the redeemed earth, is all those things that are bad, the ways that we've distorted it and broken it, he's going to take that away, right? So I joked a little bit in the first service, and I said this, we're going to be here. And you can go out and look at the sunset or the sunrise or whatever, but there's not going to be sub-zero temperatures, right? There's not going to be anything freezing inside my nostrils. I'm not going to get shocked every time I touch metal from like December through March, right? I said there's probably going to be no mosquitoes. The hot light will always be on at Krispy Kreme because you could eat as much as you want and God's going to take the calories away. And I said there's going to be no cats. Yeah. I'm kidding if you're a cat lover. I said I wasn't going to say anything about cats till the new year, and it's the new year. No, listen, I joke, but I'm telling you this. If you've ever experienced that sunrise or that sunset, or you've been up on a ski lift and you look down at the beauty of the snow and you've known that there's a creator, you know more about heaven and eternity than you think you do. Because God says, I'm going to restore it. I'm going to redeem it to its original intent. And everything that you've done to break it and distort it, I'm going to take that away, and you're going to dwell with me in fellowship forever, right? That's what a picture of heaven's going to be like. Just go outside and watch a sunrise. Go outside and intentionally watch a sunset, but there's going to be no pain, no disease, only perfection. This is how God says it in the book of Revelation, through John. He says this, Revelation 21:4. He says, he, that's God we're talking about, will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. God's going to take everything that's bad and broken that we've done to this, and he's going to take it away. He's going to remove it. No more cancer, no more violence, no more death, no more suicide. No more. Why? Because God's going to redeem it and restore it to the design that he had when we read about it in the book of Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2 before the fall. That it's going to be perfect fellowship. When you read the book of Genesis, you see Adam and Eve had everything that they could ever want, right? And then they bought into the lie that we do today. I make a better God than you, so I'm going to choose to do the own thing. God says, listen, that's what it's going to be. You don't read Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. You don't read that and see Adam and Eve talking about, man, we're going to die one day and we're going to go to heaven, right? They didn't even have a framework for that because they walked in fellowship with God in God's beauty. God says, I'm going to kainos, I'm going to restore and redeem the earth. To make sure we understand it, in verse 5, Revelation 21, 5, it says this, he, God, who was seated on the throne, said this, I am making everything new. Everything new. Now, isn't that good news for us? So why in the world, listen to me, why in the world would we ever hold on like this to this life if we get an accurate picture that God's going to restore and redeem and put everything back? And you know, all the things that were beautiful and great about this place, why would we ever hang on to this life the way it is instead of saying, God, come now, come now? I think that if you and I could grasp this, it would change everything for us. I think that if we could grasp this and we could help people understand this, I think that it would change. Because the church, typically, I think what we do is we try to scare the hell out of people, right? We're going to scare hell out of you, right? But we're not going to give you an accurate picture. So we say, here's your choices. You believe in Jesus or you're going to go burn eternally, right? Or the other side of it is, you can go sit in a room and you could sing 24/7, right? Well, what if you gave them an accurate picture of what eternity in heaven really looked like? That sunrise, sunset, meals, everything. You understand that God created everything to draw us back to Him, right? The flavors of food that He gave us so that when we ate them, we would say, God, you are so creative. It's amazing, right? And we've turned it into gluttony, right? Everything. Everything that He's created, He's given us as a tool to push us back to Him, and we take it and we distort it and we destroy it. And God says, no, that's not how it's going to be, because I am going to kainos. I'm going to restore it and redeem it, and you're going to live in perfection with me. Now, if you gave people that picture, right, no more disease, no more crying, no more suicide, no more of those things. Instead, every bit of beauty with God forever. Do you think that would change? Do you think that's a different approach than saying fire insurance, right? Do you think that's a different approach? See, I think what happens is we've gone out and we've given people a misguided, a skewed view of what eternity in heaven's really like. So I think that if we could just get this, it would just change everything. It's just different. Now, how does this change the way that I live my life now? How does it change the way that the thoughts that I have? How does it change every single moment of every single day? Here's the second misconception. What you do on this earth determines whether you go to heaven, but once you get there, it's the same for everybody. Okay? Second misconception. What I want you to understand is you only spend eternity with Jesus if you have a personal relationship with Him now. Bible's clear, that's the only way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Not a way, right? That if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. Bible is clear that the only way that we have a relationship with Him is through faith, okay? But when we think that once everybody gets there, it's all going to be the same for everybody, that's wrong thinking as well, right? Now, here's another thing. If you think, well, I've got a personal relationship with Jesus, but I'm going to just do what I want to do because God's going to forgive me anyway, let me just say this. There are bigger issues going on in here. If you're living your life thinking, God's going to forgive me anyway, God's got grace, right? Grace means I can do whatever I want, and He's going to forgive me anyway, I would say there's something deep going on that we need to talk about. But Scripture is very clear that the only way that we get to spend eternity with Him is through a personal relationship with Him, but it's not going to be the same for everybody. It's not. Certainly, the least in heaven is going to be awesome, right? But Scripture is clear that it's not going to be the same for everybody. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 was written by Paul, and here's what I want you to understand. He wrote this to people who had a relationship with Jesus, right? He wrote this to his church, and here's what he says. He says, for we must, what? All. For we must, who is all? All, right? I mean, it's not a trick. I just wanted you to say it out loud, right? All, we must all, that's everybody who has ever lived, everybody who will ever live, and that's you and I. We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad, right? So there's coming a day. Here's what I want you to understand. There is coming a day when everybody will stand before Jesus, and some people He will say, depart from me, I knew you not, okay? Some people, He will say, well done, good and faithful servant. And this is really what the idea that Paul's addressing here, is that when we stand before Christ, we're going to give an account. right? When we stand before Christ, it means that God's paying attention. As you live your life now, God is taking notes. And I don't mean like, you know, a Santa Claus sitting back, making a list, checking it twice, going to find out who's naughty and nice. I'm not talking about that. What I'm saying is God is paying attention, though, to the way that you live your life. And there's coming a day when you're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and he's going to say to you, if you have a relationship with him, he's going to say to you, well done, good and faithful servant. And the way that you live your life, when he says to you, great is your reward. There's a way that you and I, if we would live with this mindset, that every choice, every thought that I have in my brain impacts the way that I spend eternity. Listen to me. The way that you go about your work this week, the way that you go to school, you know, so you're a follower of Jesus Christ, and you go to school, and they say, hey, we're going to go do this weekend, and we want you to join us. And you know in your head, this is inconsistent with my faith, that this is inconsistent to what God calls me to, so I'm going to choose to say no. What's going to happen? You're probably going to be ridiculed, right? And you're probably going to be cast out and pushed aside. But one day, you're going to stand before Jesus Christ, and he's going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. Great is your reward. And see, we get so wrapped up about what people think about us now and the decisions I make now and what happens if they make fun of me, and we hang on to this life because we don't have a clear picture of what eternity looks like. I want you to understand the significance of this, that there's coming a day that you and I are going to stand before Jesus. And if we've lived our life in such a way, every business deal, every you know, as I farm, as I play sports, as I parent my children, as I interact with my spouse, if we live in such a way that honors God, if we live in such a way that he's called us to, he's going to say, great is your reward. Great is your reward. How you and I live now impacts eternity. Every moment of every day impacts eternity. And we need to understand that. Knowing this, listen to me. Here's my challenge for you. I want you to be intentional this week with someone. I want you to be intentional this week with someone. I want you to make an intentional decision this week that reflects not the myths about we're going to be, you know, fat babies with harps or wings or sitting in clouds or sitting in a sterile room or mopping floors with Morgan Freeman. Not that. I want you to make an intentional decision this week that reflects what you understand about what we were just talking about. And I want you to act on that, right? It could be in your marriage. It could be with someone at your work. It could be something that you did for another person. It could be the way that you pursue a new relationship. I want you to make a decision, an intentional decision that will stand the test of time. Timeless, right? Make a decision that's going to impact eternity. Spend your life this week in a way that's going to be timeless. There's so many distractions that we have, so many things that pull and tug at us, and I want you to spend this week walking around with a heightened awareness of eternity. We believe around here that what matters most is. So maybe say, I'm going to be intentional this week to start praying for the people. I haven't been praying for the people that I know that don't have a relationship with him, but I'm going to be diligent this week to pray for the people that I know that don't have a relationship with him. I'm going to be diligent this week, you know, where I had this thing coming up and I was thinking maybe I would go this way. You know what? Not this week. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to choose to go this way because I know that that's what God's calling me to. And I was going to take the easy way out because I didn't want to deal with those consequences. But you know what? In the grand scheme of life, this is just a boop, and eternity's coming, right? I want you to be intentional this week to make decisions that impact eternity. I want you to meditate on this truth. My choices matter forever. The choices that you and I make matter forever. I want you to think about how that plays out in your life. I want you to think about how it plays out in your relationship with your kids or your relationship with your spouse or when my kids disrespect me. I have an option, right? I have a choice. I can go back at them and be disrespectful to them, or I can say, no, I'm going to show them what God looks like through how I parent them. I just want you to be intentional. And that's what I want us to do throughout this whole series, is to make choices, to implement a set of core values, to do life in such a way that really in this little blip, it doesn't matter because I'm thinking bigger picture. I'm thinking of eternity. And there's coming a day when I'm going to stand before Christ and he's going to talk to me. And he's going to say, you know what? I know that you had a choice that day. And instead of doing that, and I know that you were tempted to do it, but you chose to live your life honoring me. Great is your reward. Well done, good and faithful servant. Sound good? We ready? Okay. All right. Awesome. You know what? Let's clap for God. How about that? Is that weird? So what? Right? It's awesome. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, you know what, God? I'm so grateful that it doesn't have to be a mystery. And God, I'm grateful that everything that's good and pure about this life is going to be infinite in eternity. That God, that's the picture that you want me to see. And that I'll spend an eternity with you there. I'm not going to sit in some clouds. God, I pray that as I walk out of here, that as we walk out of here, as we do life every single day, that God, we would live life in such a way that we consider eternity. What are the eternal consequences? That God, if there's someone we know that doesn't have a personal relationship with you, that God, we are intentional about praying for them, reaching out to them, developing a relationship with them. God, if there's someone that you bring across our heart and our mind, that rather than ignoring that, God, we'll reach out because people are hurting. God, I pray that as we live life and as my children disrespect me or as something comes up at work that doesn't go my way, rather than reacting, God, I am intentional to live in such a way that brings you glory and honor. And God, I am grateful that one day I'm going to stand before you and give an account. My prayer for us is that each and every one of us sitting in here will hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Your reward is great." God, it's by you and for you and through you that we do this. In Jesus' name, amen.